Welcome, welcome, welcome. Welcome back to The Focus. Everybody's healthy.
For the most part.
Present and accounted for.
Last show was rough, but we got through it. Before we get started, you know, we're going to touch on local coverage real quick, and then we're going to get right to the show with our guests and a lot more. I'm going to start things off Saturday. Had the chance to go down to St. Mary's County, St. Mary's College, actually. They hosted number 3, Christopher Newport University. For those of you that don't know, they're ranked 3rd in the country in the Division III. They're smacking people. They're well-coached, great program. They beat the Seahawks 88-61. It wasn't even that close. I mean, you know, St. Mary's kind of put up a fight in the first half. They got it down, you know, to 6, you know, 26-20. But behind their post player, Tim Daly, who posted 28 points and 11 rebounds and 3 assists, they just dominated them. They pounded it inside religiously. They swarmed them on defense. They played a complete game, and the Seahawks really couldn't recover. They jumped out to 11-0 run. St. Mary's rallied, like I said, to make it 6. But then they went on a 22-2 run to take a 48-22 halftime lead, and it was over after that. Guard Matt Ayoub led St. Mary's with 18 points in the loss.
That quick, okay. So I was busy on Instagram at the moment. I gotta put my phone back down because Cardell's already done. For my portion of local coverage this week, before we get to talking to our guest Rob, and we're so happy to have you here.
I'm happy to be here. You know,
since it's your first time here after the whole rebranding type thing, you know. So welcome to The Focus.
Appreciate it.
As he already let everybody know, we're happy to be back too. For local coverage, is more Maryland women. They had 2 road games last week. They took advantage of both games. You know, they're still continuing to build. I know I've been saying this every week. They're not a finished product yet. But at the same time, they've only had that loss to UConn. And the good thing with some of these road games, they're getting tested a little bit. Right. Destiny hit another 30-footer. And then Shatori hit like a 60 or 70-footer at the end of the third quarter of the game on Sunday. To end the third quarter, so they like long shots, apparently. that's what's going on in the water there. But our guy, Jarrell Leeper, went to College Park last week, caught up with Shatori Walker-Kimbrough. They had a great conversation, so we're going to let you guys check that interview out right now in its entirety, and then we're going to go to a quick break, and when we come back, we're going to talk hoops to the guy with Kentucky on his shirt. There's a purpose for him being here. And Rob's off that Marshawn Lynch. We know why he's here when he shows up. If he walks anywhere around us, the Kentucky is fully repped.
We're going
to jump into this interview, take a quick break, and we'll rejoin you on the other side. You're watching The Focus.
From when I saw the game, like, it was kind of close in the beginning. In the third quarter, you start to pull away. Tell me about that.
Yeah, our bench was key. Aisha Small and Brianna Frazier had a really good spark. Especially, I know defensively and offensively, Brianna Frazier, they didn't have an answer for her. Aisha, I mean, she was just in attack mode, just being aggressive, and we needed that spark, and it came up big.
All right, now, a year ago yesterday, you dropped 41 against Purdue, and yesterday you had 12 points. Explain what they do differently against you.
I just feel like we were just taking what the defense was giving us.
Right.
It was really balanced scoring yesterday, and I think that was really, it's going to be key in the long run. Because, I mean, we just have so many weapons. I mean, Destiny from the outside, Kyler Charles being aggressive on the inside. Like I said, Brianna Frazier didn't have an answer for us. Bree Jones walking double-double. I mean, we're just so balanced this year. So, I mean, we were just taking what the defense gave us.
Right. Now, coming in this year, you have no one recruiting class. And explain, like, how has it been, like, molding them and seeing them progress and grow and help you dominate this year?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I actually forget that they're freshmen until people bring them up to me. I mean, like, Destiny Slocum, like I was saying yesterday, she is a freshman point guard on the number 3 team in the country, and she's running us. I mean, we trust her with everything. I mean, she's running our offense. We have confidence in her. I mean, she's taking NBA threes and knocking them down with confidence.
Like Steph Curry.
Yeah. I mean, like against UConn, the number 1 team in the country, she's knocking them down confidently. And so we see our point guard have that confidence. We just follow her lead.
All right. And with a couple more games in the Big Ten matchup, like how you feel the state of the team's mentality is like going into the Big Ten tournament and ultimately NCAA tournament?
Yeah, Coach, she really preaches taking one game at a time. You never want to look over anyone, because I think the Big Ten is very strong from top to bottom. Like, we have a great, we're going against a great Indiana team on Sunday, going to into Assembly Hall, and not an easy place to play in, so we just got to make sure we stay locked in on each and every game ahead of us.
All right, now I was watching some old videos of you. I think it was Drew Brody, he did a package on you in 2014. Like, seeing you as a freshman, compare where you were then to what you are now, like, what are you thinking about?
Yeah, just being able to bring whatever the team needs me for that specific game. Like, if coach needs me to be a lockdown defender, if she needs me just to communicate, if she needs me to score, if she needs me to make the easy plays. I'm just trying to be a very versatile player, and I didn't really know how to do that my freshman year. So just being able to be more versatile this year and just being able to do whatever my team needs me to do.
Right, and speaking of your versatility from freshman and senior year, your name's going to be in the Raptors along with Bree Jones. How does that feel like?
I was speechless. I mean, it's literally it's an honor to be named amongst the legends that played here. I mean, you got Marissa Coleman, you have Christy Tolliver, who just won WNBA championship. I mean, those are legends. Lynetta Kaiser, Crystal Langhorne. I mean, I can go on. Alyssa Thomas. Like, yeah. I mean, these are legends. And and it hasn't even hit me yet. I mean, it's just like, I'm just speechless.
Now, you and Bree, I spent 4 years together. Like, explain what, like, she means to you as a teammate and as a leader on this team as well.
Yeah, she means the world to our team and to me. I mean, we've grown together. I mean, I just remember coming in with her in the summer. I mean, she had came off an ACL tear. I mean, and just how much weight she's lost. I mean, I just remember her going up and down those steps with right. weights, sweat. I mean, I know she was just like, I don't know if I'm gonna make it. I mean, and she just grinded it out. And I mean, she never complained once. I can say that about her. She never complained once. And I would just be looking at her like, I don't know how she's doing it. I mean, she's doing rehab. She's doing lifts. She's doing this like extra work, just trying to get in back into shape. And she's just come a long way. She's came a long way. And I mean, she motivates me every day. Just remember to seeing where she came from and to see where she's at now.
It's a beautiful thing to see. Now, something that's interesting, points have gone down a little bit, but the whole team feels different from last year to this year. Like, does that matter to you as long as you're winning games? Or
yeah, I just, as long as we win it, I would do whatever. If coach needs me to sit down on the bench and communicate, I'm for it. I mean, I trust her. She got a national championship, and I mean, our team is just so talented that we can, like, I mean, we can put in any five, and I think we will come out still aggressive. I mean, coach has really challenged us on our defense, and that's one thing that we definitely need to focus on. But I mean, we're just so versatile, and I think you see that in our balance scoring on the stat sheets.
Right, now you mentioned Christy Tolliver. She graduated with a career 40.8% 3-point percentage, and you have 45%. So unless you just miss a whole bunch of threes from now, you're gonna be the all-time leader. Like, what does that feel like?
It's actually mind-blowing, because in high school, like, I was never ever looked to as a 3-point shooter. Like, I would catch the ball and they would just tell people to back up because they just knew I couldn't shoot. And that was one thing I wanted to get better at. I focused on, because, I mean, I knew that I was taking away shots from my other teammates. So if they respect me from the three-point line, that opens it up one-on-one for Bree Jones in the post and just open up for driving lanes from our other guards. So that was one thing I really wanted to definitely develop coming into college. And just to be named amongst, like I said, Christy Tolliver, WNBA champion, is an honor.
Right. Now, let's switch things a little bit. I know you've been locked and focused in this season. Have you watched any NBA?
Yeah.
I know you're a big LeBron fan. Yeah. He's been struggling. He's been calling out Charles Barkley. Like, you paid any attention to that, or you just locked in this season?
Yeah, I mean, I love LeBron. I just love basketball, so I'm always trying to be a sponge around the game, just to go to different, just listen to different coaches, listen to different players, and pick up different things from the different players in the league.
All right, so early prediction. Mm-hmm. Are they going to repeat, or?
Absolutely.
They going to repeat?
Absolutely.
Is it going to be 7 games again, 4, or just as long as they repeat?
Yes, as long as they repeat. We got Kyle Korver coming in. We waiting for a healthy J.R. Smith. So, I mean, it'll be a good one, but I think they're going to go.
Do they need another playmaker, though? That's what LeBron's been.
I mean, LeBron got 100 million reasons to be a playmaker, in my opinion.
Absolutely. LeBron just should have 100 million reasons.
Exactly, yeah. So, but I do think, I mean, they have the talent. I mean, Golden State is amazing to
they
watch.
They added another cheat code in Kevin Durant.
Yes. It'll be fun to watch, but my loyalty is to LeBron.
All right, we'll see what happens. Now, as you prepare for a game, like, what goes through your mind? What music are you playing? Like, do you do any special routines to get ready for a game?
I like some Meek Mill, but I like to make sure I'm out on the court like 2 hours before our pregame starts, just to get in the rhythm, shoot some threes, but not necessarily a routine. Just trying to get the ball in my hands, just trying to get in the mode, some sweat flowing. But I mean, I'm just so antsy that I try to get on the court as soon as possible.
Hey, I feel that. Last question, like, what did it take for you guys to beat a tough Indiana team?
Defense. That's the number one thing of our Maryland identity. We try to defend, rebound, and run. So we want to limit their shots, make them take tough shots, and get out and run in transition. Continue to be aggressive, and I mean, continue to stick to our identity. We want to be the best Maryland team we can possibly be.
All right, Shatori, good luck. Thank you. And have a great game.
Welcome back to The Focus. Thank you so much for tuning in and listening again this week. So we're going to jump right in to our guest. We have Rob here today. How you doing, sir?
I'm good. How are you?
Good, good. So, Cardell, take it away.
What's up with your Wildcats?
Straight to the point, no pet cards.
Straight to it. We could just call it growing pains right now. I mean, we're doing work right now, as you can see, the LSU score. But
LSU,
I think honestly, I think it's just growing pains. I mean, you know, I think as a Kentucky fan, I've been spoiled. We've been spoiled. Big Blue Nation's been spoiled. You know, just for having guys just being able to come in and make the transition right away. But last year, as you can see, Scow, it took him a while. This year, you know, we have got kids basically growing up and trying to become men in like 110 days before March Madness. So. I mean, it's just growing pains. I mean, I think now we can appreciate the coach of, you know, the coach that Kyle is, and we'll go from there. We'll see.
Really?
Yeah. I still got faith.
I think that was a great answer.
It's very politically correct, really. You appreciate it. Coach Kyle is okay.
I appreciate Coach
I feel
Kyle.
Like you rehearsed that answer.
Yeah. I thought it was great. It was
He's
great.
Very before the show.
He probably in the car before he walked in. Like, I got to give it with the right sincerity.
I mean, something's got to give, man.
So, I mean, like I said, something's got to give. Monk can't be the only one shooting jump shots like we talked about earlier. Briscoe's got to really be Briscoe, the guy from high school that dominated the circuit. Monk, I mean, like, it's Monk shows flashes. I mean, earlier, he was a top winning player earlier in the season. He's kind of that. I think that 2-3 zone when he played against Kansas really showed like he was an 18-year-old kid. Like, he didn't know what to do. And, I mean, guys just got to step up, and we'll be all right.
What about Bam, Wenyen?
Wenyen, I think.
De'Aaron.
Wenyen is having the scowl effect a little bit. He shows flashes. But, like, I mean, he just started playing basketball a couple years ago. So, I mean, it's coming along. It's going to be there. Bam, I think Bam needs to get the ball more. Kyle's been preaching that all season. I mean, he's Dwight Howard, Sean Kemp combined. He's a grown man. Like, I mean. You've seen the highlights. The kid is unstoppable at times. So, I mean, he's just got to get the ball more. I think, like I said, it's a learning curve. The team's going to be fine. I mean, they're going to be fine. I got faith for sure.
Florida said we think otherwise. But, all right.
A nightmare.
All right.
Killed my birthday weekend.
I know you pay attention to college more than just outside Kentucky. But who's the best freshman? Fox, Monk, Fultz, Ball, Dennis Smith, or Tatum?
I think we don't appreciate Dennis Smith enough. NC State, they're not on TV enough. I mean, the kid is unbelievable. What he did against Duke, even though that dunk that he did, even though as time regulation ended, it was just like, whoa, like, yeah, that is like an X factor right there. I think Ball gets a lot of publicity, but your boy Fultz, like, I mean, he's the real deal. I mean, if you haven't seen him play, you're missing out on some eye candy for sure. The matchup this past weekend was a dandy. Like, I mean, they both really got it in, and you could appreciate both of them. But out of all of them, I think I still like Fultz, not just from the hometown guy. I liked Fox more than all of them initially, but, like, seeing him play that 2-3 zone, I was nervous. I didn't know. It scared me. I never seen a Kentucky freshman point guard look so nervous and just out of place since Ryan Harrell, and he wasn't even a freshman. But I like Fultz. I mean, you turned me on to him, and I've been pleased ever since.
Hey, man, they told me about him when he came out of JV. And,
yeah.
you know, he played up at Hoop Hall. He actually played against Briscoe with Kyle and everybody front row. And so I was like, we going to see.
Right.
He gave him the business, man. I was like, oh, my God. He was the best. He destroyed him. And I was like, man. And ever since then, it's just been on. Like, steady, a rise. He's on his way. He in the mix. Other than player, which team has caught your eye, is the best in the country? Don't say Kentucky. Outside of Kentucky.
Outside of Kentucky, yeah, because we've looked scary at times.
Who, Maryland? What, Georgetown?
Nah. I like what I see in North Carolina at times. I think the North Carolina-Kentucky game was the best game this far this season. I like North Carolina. Villanova is tough to go against them. Yeah. They play very well. I'm not too certain on Gonzaga. I know Billis talks about Gonzaga all the time, but I haven't seen them play enough, and I'm just not too certain because, just their history. I mean, they look amazing regular season. They get in the tournament, and it's see you later. So, like I said, Villanova, I still can't count on Duke. They're going through growing pains as well. People underestimate or undermine that even though you have all these top recruits and you have all these great players and these, five stars, but these guys got to gel. There has to be some type of continuity. There has to be, a team chemistry. And these teams are struggling right now, but in March, we'll see what it made of. But Villanova looks good. Kansas, I can't stand Kansas. But Mason is playing out of this world right now. They got it. They got it going on right now. And even with the suspensions, yeah.
The other guard, what's his name? You know what I'm talking about?
With the hair.
Yeah.
He's a ball player. Vickers, all of them, and you're the freshman.
I forgot about Josh. Josh Harrison, good.
He's playing outstanding, and Carlton Bragg, and he's back off suspension. So, pretty deep. We'll see. This is why I love college basketball. One more month.
What about one more team? I'm going to just sneak in there. Arizona.
Oh, yeah.
They're deaf. Their size is crazy, man.
Size and depth, for sure. Raul Alkins. Alkins?
Raleigh Alkins.
Stud. He doesn't even start, but he's a stud. Getting Trier back, and just their bigs. He's doing a really good job out there as far as recruiting them. If we don't get him, he's definitely snagging them. So, Arizona. Wildcat Nation, I guess.
I got the big man DeAndre Ayton coming. Yeah. No one playing in the country, so it's about to be serious problems. What about area programs, Maryland, Georgetown, GW? What are your analysis,
Maryland's coming along. I feel like Melo is really taking on that closer role, and the other freshmen are flourishing. We talked about Jackson earlier. He's a stud. Hoyter, he can shoot the rock. The local kids, the kids from St. John's, Collins. He's playing really well. So, the team is young, and, they look like they're going to be good in the future. And like I said, Melo is just, I got this, guys, at the end of the day.
What about Georgetown?
Georgetown, honestly, I haven't paid too much to Georgetown this season. But the couple games I did see them play, they played pretty well. I'm just so frustrated in Georgetown because I feel like they should be there, and it's just not happening. And we've talked about this multiple times about Thompson, but I like Peak a lot, so we'll see. At Georgetown, they're still not there.
And Rodney Pryor,
certainly. Like, Pryor.
He tore it up this time. I knew he was gonna have a big season because he went to work and kind of like.
Yeah.
GW, what about them?
GW, like we were talking about earlier, they made the adjustment from the coaching and everything. They're going to get better. It's just like, when
they're very young.
Yeah, they're very young.
They got like seven freshmen.
Yeah. Yikes.
A high school team, varsity team. Yeah, so, that's the learning curve. Like I said, when you got Kentucky grabbing five kids, and then you got, Duke grabbing five other kids, and then, you're left with guys that are going to take a little longer to get to their peak, it's just a learning curve. You just got to bear with your team. And like I said, this is why I just love college basketball. Right. To really see guys really grow, it's unfortunate that they leave that early. But, just to see the kids grow into men and then, go off and do great things, I think.
I agree. Bobby Knight said it best. He said, man, in high school, you showcase your talent, but college, you learn the game. You learn how to play basketball. So
That's perfect.
We're going to jump to the pros, man. I know you saw the Wiz and Cavs game. We gonna get on that a little bit more later. But who do you feel is the biggest threat? If there was a team you could choose to take out the Cavs, who would it be?
Um, on paper, I thought Indiana was going to be that team. I mean, from top to bottom, the size, you know, Paul George was coming into his own and it seemed to be struggling. I don't know if they're not gelling yet. You know, you can wait till All-Star break, but it's just something's not there. And then the Raptors are doing, you know, I guess pretty well.
Because DeRozan got hurt. That's when he got the slide back. Mm-hmm. You know, he came back last night. So.
Yeah. But like I said, I think Indiana was the team that I was hoping or looking for to take that next leap and, you know, be at least in contention with the Cavs a little bit. But like I said, I mean, as long as LeBron's playing these and, you know, with the team that he has, I mean, I guess they're their biggest opponent, honestly, in my opinion.
Okay. What about out west? You know, who the biggest threat to, you know, I kind of put the Warriors and Spurs even.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But, I mean, who the biggest threat to, you know, possibly knock them off, if there is anyone?
It's tough. I mean, the Clippers tease us every year, and then it's like, it happens like dominoes. If Paul gets hurt, then Griffin gets hurt, and then it's like playoffs, and you're like, both of them are hurt. So it's like, I think they tease us, but, I mean, Westbrook is doing as much as he can, but at the end of the day, you know, these are the two superior teams. And I think, you know, hopefully we get that showdown between those two. And but like I said, I mean, with the team that the Warriors have right now, it's just video game. Like, and then when they're going, it's just – it's crazy. Like, I mean, I've been blown away a couple of times how just, like, the ball works around the arc and it's just cash, cash, cash. Like, it's a video game. It's crazy. Like, so – but – like I said, outside of that, though, the Warriors and the Spurs, I mean, it'll be one of them, one of those two. Hopefully we'll get round three and we can settle it there and make it a robbery.
Okay, and had an interesting game, you know, Super Bowl Sunday. You know, what's your thoughts on that?
Very interesting. Like we talked about earlier, I'm a Brady fan, you know, number 10, University of Michigan, Brady. I like that guy when he was struggling with Drew Henson.
All these faces.
The reason I'm making this face.
It's the hat, man.
No, this is even more so than the hat. Like, I already got past the hat. Uh-huh. I just might not make eye contact because of the hat. But nah, like, it's just the University of Michigan all of a sudden coming out of nowhere, like, we love Tom. Like, it's if it was consistent, I'm cool with it.
Right?
This isn't his first championship.
No, it's not.
But, like, it just, I saw so many pictures from, like, the Michigan Wolverines account. Uh-huh. Just like, y'all do it. You're doing entirely too much. You didn't love this dude that much when he was there.
I mean, but he was struggling to get on the field when he was there. If it wasn't for Drew Henson not going to play with the Yankees, it's a good chance Tom Brady might not even be drafted in the sixth round.
Where was this love after the first one?
After the first
one? Or the second
one? It's history, that's why.
From Michigan. From Michigan. Because this is what's irked me. Michigan's all of a sudden like, we're a proud alma mater.
Well, Harbaugh has changed, you know, the whole thing at Michigan. I mean, the guys that he's bringing there, the satellite trips.
I mean, that one Brady thing go up.
Brady was just there. Brady was just there when he was on suspension. When it was a home game, he was at Ann Arbor. So I mean, so
because he had nothing else to do. He was at Michigan.
He was throwing routes to his son. So he was working out. He was on suspension, but. I mean, we cannot undermine the greatness of Tom Brady.
I'm not going here. I'm
the greatest quarterback
of all time.
I mean, he's by far the greatest quarterback that I've seen. But I mean, like I said, I think if you pull up the numbers with him in Montana, I mean, he's got the nod. And if you were looking for that impeccable moment, that Montana moment, I think that was it.
He got the nod with numbers.
The Super Bowls, the championship. I mean, the Super Bowls. I think the MVPs, and it was. It was something else that was, I'm not sure if it was yardage or wins. Might have been wins.
Yeah, he got
to
be wins.
Yeah, it was wins. And he's got the nod. But if you, like I said, if you were looking for that impeccable moment, I mean, 28-9. I mean,
for Montana, 11 touchdowns, no interceptions, baby. No losses. He's like, what is this losing? I can't relate, Brady.
When you're playing with a bunch of guys like us put into a system. I mean, Montana really had the greatest receiver of all time. He played with Roger Craig.
First one.
I mean,
exactly.
Maybe not the first one, okay, but the bulk of his career. I mean, we look at what Brady did with Moss for those two seasons. He rewrote the history book. If he would have had someone of that caliber the majority of his career, I mean,
Gronk,
who knows?
Gronk is not a Hall of Famer. Martellus Bennett's not quality.
I mean, he's quality.
Edelman's not quality.
Look what Edelman had to do to get on the field.
What do you mean?
It took him a while to get on the field.
I mean, he's one of the better slot dudes. Like, he's back. Since his time in the league.
And Blunt? Like Deion said, you don't want to smoke that blunt.
Listen, but I'll say, look,
not
Tom Brady's.
Like
yeah, the supporting cast that he's had. I mean, these guys are shuffled in and year out. I mean, Gronk, yeah, he's. Gronk is amazing, but where was Gronk didn't even play this past game. He's always hurt. So, I mean, like I said, the Tom Brady for me, I mean,
okay.
Impact Google, man.
I even got to the place where I'm cool with the best quarterback.
Right.
I just drew the line with the best football player ever. I refuse to go that far with
okay,
it.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, I'm not saying you. I'm just saying, like, since it happened, that's where people have been going, like, oh, my gosh. Like, he's doing it. Like, that. It's him. And all be all. I'm not there with it yet.
But if you look at the position of the quarterback, I mean, it's the most high profile position on the football field. So I mean.
But at the same time, like, I guess my whole thing is, like, I give him a lot of credit.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, you also had the greatest coach ever in the NFL.
Yeah, that's true.
Which, like, that's kind of a big deal to have in your back pocket.
Yeah.
Like, I know you got the cooking in that comeback, but the Jedi mind tricks that Bill Belichick plays on opposing teams.
The adjustments.
Yeah, he signed that coaching study.
We're gonna get in. Did you see him snatch the headset from them dudes in second half? It was like he took notes in the first half. Like, cut his mic. You know, he got loose. He started walking up and down the side. He looked real active in the second half.
Yeah,
I'm not saying he caught everything, but I don't think Matt Patricia did much.
It looked like he was entertained, and it was like, oh, finally. I got a chance to really show how good I am now. Like,
and he just flexed real quick. And I mean, like, I think Brady's great, but that dude is amazing.
Yeah,
I gotta give like, he's the best.
Yeah.
Like, think about what he did. Like, he really played the greatest mind trick on Matt Ryan. Like, he told him Julio Jones has two people on him, but at the same time, we taught that two people wasn't enough. Yet he tricked him into believing, like, conventional thinking. That I shouldn't throw into that double team, which is really a single team,
because
it's 80-20. But I'm going to try to spread it to everybody else, who now you threw wrinkles into everybody else. And they not open.
Yeah.
You know who he really – I mean, I agree with you, but you know who I think he really got in the heads of? The coach and stuff.
Oh,
no, he definitely got that.
Even Shanahan at the game was like, I blew that, because he made Shanahan get out of character. Like,
yeah, he's got super aggressive.
What got them good field position for Matt Ryan, they ran the ball. They only ran the ball four times in the second half.
You know what the big thing with that, and I do agree with you? When Campbell, Coleman got hurt. Mm. It's because I love Devontae, but he's not a 3 yards in the cloud of dust dude. But still, four running plays is crazy. Yeah. But like you said, he gets you so far in your mind that you don't know right
pressure,
from wrong, left and right. Like you said, now it's pressure.
It's pressure because it don't apply to players. It apply to coach. Like, oh, man, I got to do with Brady. Oh, my. And then Brady just, like, and he commented. It's like, oh, my God, we got to do something. Like, you get out of
domino
ball,
effect.
He even got you to play zone. You had no reason.
That was prevent defense. And like, Brady, like, really? Prevent against
me? He saw zone and was like.
Yeah, he loved.
Hey, Tom, take this work.
Carved him up.
And then defensively, it was just crazy because it went from all this space, all these things that we can do, so he put you in a box all of a sudden. Mm-hmm. And like you said, Kyle, like all those great formations that we saw in the first half, they literally couldn't get to 30. If they got to 30, it might have been cool. Mm-hmm. They couldn't get to 3 points to put him in a safe, like that safe place.
Mm-hmm.
Man, they just couldn't get it. That sack, man. Oh,
hey, that sack, there was a part of me, and I couldn't say it on Twitter, because... The petty in me.
Uh-oh.
Like, my mentions would have went crazy. Because we do this a lot with other quarterbacks that look different, that refuse to throw the ball away and in certain situations. So for all those people like, oh, it's the play call, I don't hear that excuse for those other-looking quarterbacks. The guys that look a little different, it's regardless of the play call, you're supposed to get rid of the ball. So, Matty Ice, what you doing taking that sack, young man? Like, I know Kyle was tripping a little bit, and that's cool. You the NFL MVP, young man. I'm looking at you. You just won an award. You won two awards the night before.
Hey, man.
Two awards.
Uh-huh. Championship pedigree is real. I mean, we saw last night with
like
the Wiz and Cavs, man. It's just
you
got to know how to win. Yeah. And they do, so it is what it is.
It was hilarious. Because, like, even when they were up, like, I refused. Like, I just couldn't. When it was 28, 21-3, 28-9, whatever. Mm-hmm. I never felt like the Falcons had it.
Yeah. Oh, no.
Because it's like, in the back of my mind, I'm like, all right, y'all got a big lead, but technically your offense only scored twice.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, from a technical standpoint, you only drove the length of the field twice. Secondly, there's a whole bunch of big plays, which we know, those are kind of anomalies against Bill Belichick defense for the most part. Eventually, you're going to have to put together, like, an 18-play drive, which you, if you had one of those drives in the second half, Super Bowl champions, you're not going to grind them, like, out-grind them.
Look, man.
Like that. And it was beautiful.
I mean, yeah, you're right. Beautiful and the one thing, I said if they would have scored one more time, I think that would have put them away.
That was it.
But they couldn't do it. But the thing with Brady, when he loses, he's getting hit a lot. Mm-hmm. If you notice, my Broncos did it. The Giants did it.
With straight handing them.
When the Ravens broke through, they did it. They was doing that in the first half, but their defense got tired because the offense was kind of like three and out. And then the second half, they couldn't get there.
When they said after running, when the Patriots like, just kill this running stuff, we going to go 19 wide because y'all want to rush the passer. You're not going to consistently be able to rush the passer every play, and they're in empty formation. You just not. And now your linebackers that were running up the field, now we got to cover. You know, and again,
man, no quick receivers. Yeah, man, they're running all.
Like, I'm sure they didn't go into that game going, hey, James White, you about to be the dude. You're going to be the key. But you talk about coaching and adjustments. It was like, you're the guy consistently winning the matchup. He got the ball over and over.
And one of the quarterbacks for the Falcons, what's his name, Poole?
That safety, Portland.
Man, he was getting destroyed. I know Bella, they came in the game like, we getting at him. Like, every play, I'm
you
like,
you have been selected.
He was right, but I mean, every time they caught the ball, I'm like, who's that again? Beat every time. He turned around, pool. I'm like, oh my.
It's the same one. You know, like,
if they find you,
it's over.
What movie was it when they was like looking around and looking for the dude that was shook with the wide eyes and they were like, it's you? Was it Waterboy or something? What movie was it? It was a football movie. And this dude was about to kick off. It was a one-side kick. And they were like, which is going to be my guy?
It was Waterboy.
Can't say the word. Because it's not
Bobby too clear.
Yeah, it was
the
Waterboy.
The guy was about to kick off. He was like, which one is going to be my guy? That was pool for Brady. And they were like, hey, but 34. We found you.
You have been selected.
Brady, and he famous for doing that. He did that to, what's that, the Steeler DB that was talking trash that month? Yeah. He picked you out. Yeah, it was.
I'm just happy that now, you know, my new head coach doesn't have celebration days. You can come to work now. Pick out your staff and stuff.
You
that's
ready?
Where I'm at in my life. So.
He's there.
I'm sorry, Atlanta.
He should be in Atlanta. I mean, he should be in the Bay by now.
Like, after they lost, that's my only thing. Now you can show up to work tomorrow.
Yeah, I was like, he should be in the Bay right now. Like,
you might as well just, you're already in Houston. You're halfway across the country.
Should I already packed up the house?
Just tell me to meet you at the headquarters. Yeah. You know, just come on, man.
Damn, they going home. It's homeboy from USC. They left on he got fired. They ain't left on the
Lane Kiffin.
They gonna Lane Kiffin him.
Nah, he just need to do the right thing. There's no reason to go back to Atlanta right now. Like, if I'm Dan Quinn, I don't know if I want to go back.
Mm.
And that's the crazy part. If you're Dan Quinn, you were on the Seahawks team when y'all did that stupidity. Did you learn nothing?
Oh yeah, he was on that staff, man. He just
like you were on that staff.
This
did you learn nothing? Like you, all you had to do was run down. Because I'm sure if Josh McDaniel was thinking something that crazy, Bill would have been like, hey, mute his mic.
Boom the ball.
Nah, it was a great game, though.
It was a great game. At least I was glad that it was at least a competitive-ish type game-ish.
Falcons fan, like, that was literally Michael Myers. Like, you got a head start, you hopped in the car, got to a new town, and he walks you down.
I mean, I feel like Atlanta just was so over the top in the sense, like, I felt like the whole city was already predicting that they were going to win. And I think that put a little bit of added pressure on them, honestly. You know, the mayor automatically, like, signed something where they were like, we're going to leave the clubs open an extra hour and a half, you know, so the whole city can celebrate. Like, they signed up on that before. So I'm like, okay. They like, Migos need to perform at halftime. They about to go crazy. They in Houston. Everybody, like... I was just like, yeah, I probably should have just been quiet, you know, sign the order afterwards.
Focus on the game.
I thought
you gotta make adjustments. They didn't make adjustments.
I mean, but that's the thing. Like you said, as a championship culture, like, that's why it's so hard. Everybody wonders why, you know, the Patriots get picked every year on purpose. You know, we hear a lot of other teams get thrown out there. We don't take them seriously. It's hard to kill teams like that.
Yeah.
Like, the teams that win championships on a regular basis, they're never going to be rushed.
Yeah.
That's the same thing. It's the same thing we talk about the Spurs. Yeah.
The pressure's on you to knock them out. Even if you get a big lead, pressure's really up now because you shouldn't have the lead. You didn't expect to have the lead.
Yep,
you tell yourself you did, but you did it. Because you didn't know that once you got it. Went up 20-some points, 25 points. Didn't know what to do after that because you're like, well,
now what?
We planned for it, but what's the next?
What do we do now?
People
walk
down. So,
I mean, I don't
know.
It is what it is,
man. Mm. It was hilarious, though. I'm happy my head coach can come to work now. We got a press conference on Thursday.
Like, so Kyle, are you there?
I expect you to hire your staff. Nobody from Atlanta. Let's go.
All right. We jumping right into rapid fire?
You know what? We're going to take a quick break. Then we come back, and we're going to jump into rapid fire because that's going to be
a doozy.
I already know. Like,
it's a doozy.
You don't even have to tell me. I didn't get a disclaimer. But I can feel disturbance in the force.
It's because so much has gone on this past week, so you can only imagine.
Not only that, but like last week we were both sick. So I know he could have turned heat up all the way. Oh, but now okay. Everyone feels good. Like I gauged the temperature and I said hi to him when he got here. I was like, I'm going to the other side. He was like, no, I'm good. I was like,
I got my shorts.
I'm not going to lie. I was like, you got cough drops? Nope.
Oh, no.
I was about to be real. But Rob, thank you so much, man. We're going to take a quick break. You guys are listening, watching, tuning in to The Focus. And the best time on the show is up next, man. Fun times. Fun times. And just want to let you guys know, hit Cardell during the week. You want something that might want to get thrown into the rapid fire? Or just period something that you want us to discuss? Hit us on social media. Let us know. But we'll be right back with Cardell trying to hurt everybody's feelings with rapid fire. You want to give us a hint?
I just need some answers as usual. Man.
Disclaimers.
It's a company line. I just need some answers.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. We all going to talk about Baylor and all that. Disclaimer. Saying I'm not some shit.
Wow.
Nah, we ain't going there.
Watching The Focus. We're going to leave that alone. Somebody did write about that. You can head to mymonosports.com for that. And after you read that, because we're not talking about that on air, head to Finest Mag. They know what they're doing over there. Cardell's an outstanding one-man band over there. I don't know how he does it. Because I get the luxury of calling like 30 people. Cardell's literally, look, man, I don't know. Your man Belichick without Brady. I don't know how he does it. But you're watching The Focus. We'll be right back.
All right, here we go. Rapid fire, everybody's favorite part of the show.
Yeah, we got to get some dramatic music.
All right, first question. Magic Johnson returns to the Lakers. Like or dislike the move?
I'm definitely a fan of that. I mean, the prestige that Magic brings to the team, and just, just the help that he can help in the front office. I mean, because obviously things, it's like they're at that point. They drafted pretty well. They have a nice young nucleus. But it's definitely, they need someone to take them to the next level. And I mean, Magic might be that guy. So we'll see, because I mean, they got a lot of young talent there. Maybe some good moves in the near future, or just development of players. So we'll see.
Yeah, I think it's a good thing. It's always good to have him back in, their whole little Laker family. And I'm pretty sure that they're excited for him to be there. And like you said, having young players, at least having somebody like him to look up to and talk to, and somebody that's actually been in, their shoes, and hopefully, give them some good direction.
Sure. Like, I mean, you probably help sell some more tickets.
That too. That doesn't hurt.
The office barely knows what they're doing. It's a nice little stopgap from people from looking at the people who are actually making mistakes. You instead go, hey, Magic's there. So now you look at with hope and optimism versus you guys have just been bungling. This entire situation, you don't know what you're doing at all. It's a very proud, like, historic franchise,
yeah.
And this is where it's currently at. So sure, let's put a Band-Aid on it. Yeah, have Magic.
Just sprinkle some magic in there.
All right, second question. Is Isaiah Thomas the best closer in the NBA? I'm going to start with you, Arte. Is he the best closer in the NBA?
That's a tough, because I'm pretty sure everybody saw Kyrie last night. So, I mean, it's pretty tough, but I definitely think he's in the conversation for that. You could definitely have to give him his props. He kills in the fourth quarter almost every game, like, consistently this year. It's not like it's been a one-off every now and then. Like, it's for some reason, it's like the fourth quarter is the first quarter for him. Like, he's like, all right, I'm rejuvenated. I just, warmed up again, and now I'm ready. So he's definitely in the conversation.
He's not the best closer, so.
It's a follow-up question.
Right now, I might go with Kyrie.
Okay. Telling you, yeah, that's tough.
Yeah, I think I might have to second that. Touched on, like, Isaiah's fourth quarter numbers are just crazy. I mean, it's time. Like, you can point at the watch. It's time. Like, but as far as like really taking over a game, and I mean not necessarily taking over a game, but closing out a game. I mean, like last night, it was just remarkable. So I'm definitely gonna have to say Kyrie as well.
Okay.
But he's a heck of a hell of a fourth quarter.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Like it's like, yeah.
I don't think anybody's trying to slight him.
No, not at all.
But Isaiah, bro, like if I had LeBron, but now I'm going. But Mavericks point guard Yogi Ferrell on a 10-day contract is averaging 17 points, 5 assists, and 4 games. Is he in the NBA to stay? Start with you.
He should have been to begin with, but you know, people like to take things from overseas sometimes for no reason. Things that are here that proved it through this whole collegiate system.
Yeah.
So yeah, he should be here. He should be here to be here to stay.
Saw it firsthand last year in Sweet 16. I think they got us out the way, and yeah, I mean he's been doing it for 4 years.
Light work.
Yeah.
Light work last year.
No, it wasn't. He definitely dealt with Tyler Ulis last year. But yeah, Yogi Ferrell. I'm hoping that he gets the opportunity, you know, further opportunities to show what he can really do in the league, and I'm glad he's taking advantage of this initial opportunity right now.
Okay.
I agree. I definitely think he should stay. I think they always like the littler players just off being little. Yeah, if you sit there and you watch, like you said, his whole body of work from, you know, actually completing 4 years of college. Like we want people to actually do. And like you say, you know, like we talked about earlier, being in high school is when you, you know, showcase your skills, but being in college is when you actually hone and learn the game. And, you know, he actually took that time to do that. So it's great that he's actually getting an opportunity to actually show that, you know, this is something that I do. Like all you have to do is give me the ball and I can do it, you know. So I definitely think he should stay, you know, because Dallas wasn't doing too hot before him, you know, to get, you know. So obviously something's working.
Okay. Well, former Bulls GM Jerry Krause was on the podcast with Adrian Wojnarowski. And he asked him, did Mike ever come to him and ask for players? And this was his quote. He never came to me and asked for other players. He never came to me and asked to draft a player. He never came to me to ask to trade for a player. Never once did that happen. Part of it was he thought he was so darn good he can win without him. I'm sure that he would say, that's nuts. I went without him. I don't care. But Michael was smart enough to understand the organization. After the first time, I understood what we had to do as an organization. He was great with it. He never complained to me. What are your thoughts on that?
Not surprised at all. Like we've had this conversation multiple times. Those guys from that era, I mean, just a different mindset. I mean, that wasn't accepted. If you were the best, you wanted to play against the best. And I certainly believe that if Magic and Larry would have teamed up, you know, the league might have been in bad shape a long time ago. But the fact that I feel like back then it was more so just like, you know, when guys used to team up in the Celtics, it was like a nursing home, like when Bill Walton just, let me just go try to, you know, see if I can at least get a ring. But it wasn't more so guys teaming up in their prime or the peak of their prime or, the end of their prime. Like, now I feel like it's just accepted, and I don't think it's really too cool at all. I mean, it takes away from the league, it takes away from competition, and it takes away, like, there's no rivalries in the league. I mean, it's just like, we go through 82 games, and okay, now here comes the playoffs, like, finally. Because, I mean, it's everyone plays on one team. It's like, so, like, I mean, like we talked about multiple times, I think AAU had really started, you know, the really mess up the whole thing, like when best friends are teaming up. And then, you know, through the college thing, and then now, I want to play with my buddy again. You know, we had fun, so. Oh, we were on the USA team together, too, so, like, but, you know, it's not nothing that I would think Michael would ever think about doing. I mean, you know, he probably might. The most I can expect from Mike is, hey, man, you think you can get me someone I can rebound down there? Other than that, nah, I'm sure he wanted the ball in his hands as much as possible.
I would say that sounds like the GOAT. That sounds like something that would happen, you know. Just like you were saying, like, back then I felt like their mindset, and they were more prideful when it comes to playing. Mm-hmm. Like, I just felt like back then they were more, like,
I don't want to have to say that, you know, I teamed up with this person to win a chip. Like, I want to be able to be to say that I did it on my own merit and I did it by myself, or I dealt with the hand that was given to me. You know, like, I'm a basketball player. I'm not a GM. I'm here to play basketball. I'm not here to pick who's going to play with me. You know, if I wanted to do that, I would be in the office somewhere trying to figure that out. So, I mean, that sounds like something that I'm pretty sure that, you know, Jordan, you know, never voiced any type of opinions about who should come, who he doesn't want to come. How much should he get paid? Like, all of that other crazy stuff. But, I mean, it sounds accurate to me. I just wish some other people would follow suit. Oh,
boy. I mean, it's a nice little mic drop from one of the dudes who ruined the Bulls. So, it's cool that you said that. I'm always going to remember you for ruining that. So, nothing you say is going to make me feel better. So, slight pat on the back. You said something nice. You're also the idiot that ruined it. But yeah, I mean, it was a more stubborn time. Like, I agree with everything you guys said. Like, the pride was too strong. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, in the competitive drives, and I'm not saying people aren't competitive now, but you're just stubborn.
Yeah.
Like, and sometimes it was in some players' detriment. Because sometimes maybe some people maybe thought they were here and they weren't. And maybe they needed one of those guys that were actually where they thought they were, and it could help a little bit. But it's a more stubborn time. So, I mean, it is what it is, but it's just kind of a mic drop for me for some of the people who even continue to throw these two things. We need to stop playing word association with those two separate people and eras and all that. Just leave them alone. Yeah. Like, just let's – that was – like, do like baseball. That was an era. This is an era. That's an era. And, that's it.
NFL's tribute to NFL greats from HBCUs, long overdue.
I'll start. Yeah, completely. Because like we talk about all the time, a lot, especially I think it was a great time to do it now too, because, you know, with everything that's going on in the world. And then of course, you know, we talked about a couple shows back about kids not wanting to go to HBCUs anymore because they don't think they'll get the exposure. They don't think they'll make it to the league. They don't think, you know, that they'll be able to, you know, progress and go forward in their career that they want to go to. But I think it was great that they showcased that, yes, you can go to an HBCU. Going to an HBCU isn't a detriment to your playing career. You know, as long as you work hard, regardless if you're at a HBCU, a PWI, Division I, II, or III, if you work hard and you do what you're supposed to do and you actually have the talent and the merit, you can make it. And these people showcase that to them. So I thought it was great.
Oh, yeah. Like she said, definitely long overdue. It was quite refreshing to actually see those guys. I mean, you know, Mel Blount, arguably one of the greatest cornerbacks of all time, you know, to see the school that he went to. Like I said, it was just refreshing. And also, like, what's going on in the world right now, you know, how divided we are. But just to see that, you know, it's, like I said, it's just a great thing to see. And just the opportunity, I mean, the stage that they took it on the Super Bowl stage, I mean, the whole world's watching, pretty much. So, I mean, just to see that, hey, you know, it's a lot going on right now, but, hey, you know, you guys are still front and plateau right here, so.
Okay. I agree with both of them. It was great. It was refreshing. I just needed to happen more than just once.
Yeah, too. Like, they should probably, like, I feel like that would be a good idea to do, like, every Super Bowl. Yeah, you know, like,
sport.
Yeah, and again, and even in every sport, too, like you said, like basketball, you know, because there are a lot of people in the NBA that came from HBCUs. Like,
a lot of people don't know.
And they don't know that, yeah. And it's like, so I definitely think it's a great idea that they should definitely do it in other sports. And more frequently, so, because, you know, kids are growing up and they're seeing this stuff and they're looking up to these people and they're like, well, he went to Alabama, so I want to go to Alabama just because, you know.
Okay. Where I'm going to go with Wizards and Cavs. After the game last night, can y'all see them in the Eastern Conference Finals?
Me personally, no. I mean, like I said, when I did cover the Wizards for a while, for some reason, the Wizards always play LeBron. They always play LeBron very well. The games are always very good. And but as far as like an Eastern Conference, it's a big step. I just don't see the Wizards. I mean, they're playing arguably some of the best basketball right now. But I don't know. It's just for my say, it's just nah. I just look at it as just another one where they played LeBron very well.
Sure.
Personally, yeah. Me personally. Yeah.
Who else in the East is doing something that they should worry about?
I'm never sold on the Wizards, to be honest.
But you sold on everybody else in the East?
No, not at all.
That's
but
my
I mean,
whole point.
But like I said, for me, just watching the Wizards year in and year out, they always play LeBron well, especially at home.
It ain't about him. because it you can come in like 500 and play LeBron tougher or be below, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
It ain't about him, what they've been doing leading up to that.
Yeah, I said, look,
that's what I'm saying.
I agree. They're arguably the hottest team in the league right now. But as far as like going to the next level, and then you're talking about Eastern Conference Finals, I mean, if DeRozan comes back and gets to the level where he was playing at the beginning of the season, mm-hmm. I don't see the Wizards knocking off the Raptors.
But you say you covered them for multiple years, then Wall and Bill knocked
a couple years ago. A couple years ago, but come on. DeRozan is definitely taking it to another level.
We have to see
is Bill going to be even healthy after All-Star break? Because that
you
buzz.
You say that about Kyle Lowry and DeRozan too.
I mean, Bradley Bill is more.
I'm just saying.
The odds of him getting hurt compared to them is highly likely on him.
I think it's a toss-up. I just think sometimes my biggest thing with the Wizards is consistency. Now, right now, they're very consistent. They're, like you said, they're on a hot streak. Even though they lost last night and it ended their, 17-game home streak or something like that. I don't even feel like – and I actually feel like that might be a good thing for them. The whole pressure of keeping this streak alive and all that other stuff, I don't feel like they need that extra pressure. But I do think it's a toss-up. I mean, I can see it. Possibly, but they just have to stay consistent throughout the whole season because, they started off really rocky, you know what I mean? Like, it wasn't like it was something slight. They started off really rocky, so, Scott Brooks is doing an amazing job. He's a great coach, and I think he's actually honing them all in together, so I think it's actually, it's possible.
I felt strongly before the year, and I'm not going to change how I feel. Yeah. Last night was, it's only surprising people who didn't pay attention all year long. No disrespect to the Raptors, but you talk about the Clippers season, people, they've been doing the same thing
that's
three
true.
Or four years, getting to the same place. So that's another team where I like DeRozan, I like Kyle, but until they like eventually change something and they actually get to where this place everyone puts them to, I'm going to feel the same way.
Even at the beginning of the season with that slide, Wall was coming off offseason knee surgery. And he even admitted I needed to get in shape. Once he got it going, it's been a curtain. So, we'll see. Last one, does Baylor deserve the death penalty?
Yes.
It's like a delay with the powers that be down there. I'm like, what is going on?
We know why, but, they should have been at it.
Yeah.
We talk about 52 alleged rapes.
Come on,
52 of them?
Numbers gone up.
52. Like, we're at, lawsuit number 6.
Bro.
Really?
Yikes.
We need to think about this?
That's my point. If it was like Howard or Bowie State, shut
y'all out of there.
Damn, yes.
I would have threw the fight. SMU technically did less.
Basically.
I'm talking about just from a morality standpoint. SMU did less. These are people out here ruining young people's lives.
Young ladies' lives. Like, yeah,
but hey.
I agree.
Death penalty.
Right. Yeah, they talked about it earlier. They had the death penalty.
All right, but we want to thank y'all for tuning in, man. We're gonna ride out with Petty Eddie. Definitely tune in next week. Same time, same place to the focus. As always, get over to Finest Mag. Follow that up by hopping over to mymomsports.com. And then follow us on every social media medium. The Focus and then The Focus TV. Or you can do it real easy. You can just go to Finest Mag and click The Focus. The Focus. We make it easy for y'all, man. Easy, buddy.
Petty Eddie coming pre-recorded again doesn't take away the pettiness. This segment is all about the Super Bowl, which was just played, won by the Patriots, lost by the Falcons. First off, if you think that the NFL or any professional sports league is rigged, think again. That sounds so dumb. Yeah, you can have your opinion and that's fine. That's fine and all, but it's the wrong opinion. That's what I'm telling you right now. It's the wrong opinion. In order for something like the NFL to be rigged, or the MLB, or the NBA, or the NHL to be rigged, there would have to be countless amount of variables that go into play. So you're telling me that these men who fight their whole lives to get to the NFL to play on the biggest stage, which is the Super Bowl, are just going to, we're going to follow a script, and we're going to not tackle you here, and we're just going to drop the pass here. No, absolutely not. If this was not the Patriots, No one would think this is rigged. By any means would they think this is rigged. But because the Patriots and they're dubbed as cheaters, which they aren't cheaters, that's just the case in point. They are not cheaters. Tom Brady isn't a cheater. Bill Belichick isn't a cheater. There is a winning franchise. They are the model of consistency in the NFL. Not for one second would I ever believe, oh, it's rigged because they just want the Golden Boy to win. Oh, really? Is that why the Golden Boy got suspended for 4 games and there was an ongoing witch hunt over the stupid Deflategate? Give me a break. Come on, man. That's the dumbest thing I've ever heard. All these factors would have to go involved for something like this to be rigged. And if it was rigged and all these players and personnel knew about it, not one person is coming out and saying something about it. Yeah, that's the argument right there that puts the rigged nonsense out of contention. As for Tom Brady and the Patriots, Tom Brady is now, in my opinion, the greatest to ever play the game. He's the greatest quarterback. He's the greatest player to ever play the game. And that's just the fact of the matter. You don't become one of the greatest overnight. He was drafted 199th overall, and he is set a trail of fire in his path. How fitting was it for Roger Goodell to hand him and Belichick and Robert Kraft the title or the trophy after all that Deflategate nonsense? He's the greatest player of all time, and it's not up for debate. Atlanta Falcons, huh. Terrible night you had in the second half. Blew a 28-3 lead and go on to lose 34-28. And that just adds to Atlanta postseason misery. It's just common. The game seemed wrapped away, and then the greatest of all time was like, nope, not yet. Here, James White, take these 14 catches and get us 20 points. And that's the matter of it. Atlanta seems to always choke in the postseason. It's the city of chokers. But again, one more time, if you think that the NFL or any other professional sports organization is rigged, you need a reality check and just realize that it's not. If that was your favorite team and they came back from 25-point deficit and win the Super Bowl, then you'd be all hype saying, oh, we're the best team now. We came back, overcame all the odds. Why can't it be for the Patriots? If you think sports are rigged, they're not. And two, if you think that, don't watch. Simple as that. That's the end of the pettiness for this week. I'd like to thank our guests. I'd like to thank everyone who watches and listens every week. You can do that same time, same place next week. Be sure to follow us all over social media. Finance Magazine, My Mind on Sports, The Focus TV, Petty_Eddie15 on Twitter, KingEdward15 on Twitter is my personal one. So same time, same place next week. Petty out.